This series might be about the coronavirus, but looking back through the thumbnails for it, and it apparently doubles as a showcase of all the mountains and stuff I've been climbing, since I don't really know what else to use in these videos. In this episode, I'll be showing phone footage of a climb up High Willays, the highest point on Dartmoor, all captured with my phone because I didn't bother taking my proper camera. Don't worry, it will be back. We didn't bother going all the way to the top because we wouldn't have seen anything up there, but to be honest, I quite like staring at the rolling clouds and imagining that it's a lot more exciting up there than it actually is. This sort of day out was a nice way of making the most of lockdown while abiding by the rules. Places like this tend to be busier than normal during lockdowns, but so what? Even if everyone on the mountain had coronavirus, I'd still have felt pretty safe up there. Since last video, on November the 5th, we entered national lockdown again because localised lockdowns didn't seem to be working. Actually, I think they were, but only about as well as could be expected. Total daily cases in England were beginning to level off after hotspots like Liverpool were locked down, but the problem is, nowhere in England avoided it this time around. Everywhere else in the country fell into that awkward gap between being okay and being so bad that it needed to be locked down. In my own city, I was watching the cases rapidly growing week on week. In the part of the city where I lived, and the regions around it, cases ranged anywhere between 10 and 60. And the actual figures are likely much higher than that, and growing quickly. It's not so much that it's approaching, it's more that it's already here and taking hold. I must admit, I'm disappointed that even with all of the restrictions in place, cases have still managed to rise enough to warrant a proper lockdown this early into winter. It was inevitable that the cases were going to rise when the government offered half-price meals everywhere for the whole of August, but looking at how it's grown, even accounting for delays, I really think that the major boom started the month after, when the schools and universities came back from holidays. Well, of course it did, how could it not? Before both national lockdowns so far, there's been a 2 to 3 week period where I feel that we've left it a bit too late to lock stuff down, and I begin to worry all the time again. I begin to see other countries like France and Germany shutting down. I have that disappointed realisation that all these safety measures weren't there to keep the cases lower, but rather just to delay how long it was before things got just as bad as they were before. I still kind of think that England deliberately locks down late to make the government's job easier by forcing other countries and individuals from England to be the first to suggest that lockdowns might be required. A popular way of dispelling the pandemic that I keep hearing is the claim that all of these cases are simply false positives from us testing on such a large scale. They point out that deaths aren't going up at the same rate. Well, of course not. Deaths always lag behind by as much as a month. But now the daily deaths have risen up to 300 or 400 cases a day again, the false positive argument has lost a lot of traction. This lockdown is meant to last until early December, at which point it may or may not be extended further. Christmas has always been a beacon of hope in a dark time of year, and here it is again. There is no way the government would risk having the country shut down over the festive period, or for the whole shopping period leading up to it. So that's why I'm hopeful that we'll get at least a few weeks of December where stuff's open as normal again. And I just hope right now that we've locked things down soon enough to get cases down to a level where it's at least sort of safe enough to visit family again come the holidays. The concern is, people aren't taking it as seriously as they did in the first lockdown. How can they? We're all tired of this now. The novelty and fear has worn off, and we're just left with that annoying voice telling us that we've got to stay inside for the foreseeable future, to battle a threat that we can't see that may or may not be where we are. My generation has always been seen as the snowflake generation. We've all had parents tell us that there's no way we would have survived the Blitz like our grandparents did. Well, I hope this year will change that perception. When you're stuck in something, then you find a way to power through it. You have to. We might not have bombs going off all around us, but there is a deadly disease killing people in the local area daily, and we're being asked to limit our freedom and enjoyment for the benefit of society. Which, if you ask me, is a more difficult request. Especially when you're seeing people abusing it all around you, reaping the rewards now, and punishing you with lockdowns later on. At least with bombs going off, we'd all be on level footing. There's no way this national lockdown will be as successful as it was the first time around, which is why further measures have been taken. Non-essential shopping areas are being closed off to prevent people from going shopping as a leisure activity. Just before this lockdown, I went to Primark. This, for me, most certainly is not a pleasurable activity. I was more like a pack mule with a bag. But being the first time I've been to a shop outside of Aldi for a number of months, it was an interesting opportunity to see how things have changed. And I was kind of disgusted by what I saw. You wear a mask, it's not a big request. It might be of questionable benefit or effectiveness, but so what? In my opinion, it's become more of an indicator of how selfish you are. You get people wearing them properly. Aren't their eyes beautiful? Most people do wear them. Well done. Then you get people wearing them on the chin, who I've decided must be doing it intentionally to comply by the rules just enough to get away with it, but who are making a statement about how little they want to follow them. Screw those people. And then you get people who don't wear them at all. Of these people, many are exempt for a range of acceptable reasons. But I can't go along with that. This is one area where I simply refuse to agree with what the government's doing. There is no good reason for why you shouldn't be wearing a mask in a shop. If you're fat or struggle to breathe, then that's even more reason for why you should be taking every measure possible to avoid getting this disease. If you have autism or reduced vision, then I don't see why that's an excuse to put others at risk. If you are able to get to a shop, then you are able to put a mask on. I can't help but think bad thoughts about those four fat people shuffling around in the cushion section, or those chavs in the pub who, when asked to put a mask on, said they were exempt and then exited out the entrance for a smoke. I accept these are examples of a visible disability, like obesity or sheer stupidity, but even for the hidden disabilities, while I'm all for making exceptions in most cases, mask wearing isn't one of them. While I'm on the topic of masks, I think I found another hole in our coronavirus defence strategy. Children don't have to wear masks, and it's not like they can't spread it just because they're small. And I understand that children have to be somewhere, and for the economy's sake it's best that they're at school while their parents are at work or whatever, but it seems like such a gaping flaw in the system. Last month I went to pick up a takeaway from a fish and chip shop, and all of the adults were being well behaved, wearing masks and socially distancing, and then there were a load of children peering over the counter, no masks on and their heads managing to reach just over the counter while remaining below the coronavirus barrier. England, please fix. Just my thought of where the spread's coming from at the moment. What a depressing video this has been so far, but I'd like to end on some positive points. I found the adverts this year fascinating. Almost every one of them has been shaped by the pandemic in some way or another, whether they're for sprays that kill 99.9% of viruses, hint hint, or if they're about how things are bad right now but hopefully this product will make you happier, or how they show people in close proximity to each other and a disclaimer at the bottom making it clear that it was all filmed before the pandemic started. I hope some of these will be up on YouTube for us to look back at later on, but I won't be bothering to upload them myself. Another positive is the delayed testing. It's horrible to see 20,000 plus cases a day becoming the norm, and to see so many people dying every day. But this does mean that when the government finally decides to end lockdown, even if cases still seem a bit high, if last time was anything to go by, then it'll continue to drop for a number of weeks, long after people have started going outside again. It gives everything that happy glow for a few weeks, when we need it so desperately. But we first have to earn it with this period at the start of lockdown. I'm pleased that different countries are all approaching this lockdown in different ways. I think earlier in the year it was more of a widespread knee-jerk response to the virus, but this time I like to think that they've all had months to study the data and to think up more elegant solutions. France, for example, is locking down but keeping schools open. Germany's lockdown isn't as strict this time around. And ours, in keeping with this country's tradition, seems about as confusing and as vague as always. Now onto vaccines. They've been on the horizon for months, but almost out of nowhere there's suddenly casual talk about them just being deployed. If you had asked me to guess how many different vaccines were being created, given how massive an undertaking such a thing would be, my blind guess would have been about a dozen. So it was surprising to discover that almost 100 different vaccines are being investigated by various companies across the world. But that's reassuring, isn't it? Because that must greatly increase the chances of an effective vaccine coming out, and sooner. The one from Oxford was the one I had heard most about, but it's hit a few snags in trials. Firstly, they had to investigate a suspected side effect, and then somebody on the trial died, but later was discovered to have been in the group that had taken the placebo. It's worrying that just a few individuals can halt such a massive project, but also it's great that it's being done properly, and being taken seriously. England is set to receive 10 million samples of another vaccine by the end of this year, which will be given to those most at risk or in the most sensitive of professions, followed by just those who are generally old and who work as social workers. It will then work its way down the age groups, based on how much of the vaccine we receive and so on. I'm not at risk, so I don't believe I'll be getting one for a long time, if ever. But stuff like this is making me feel like all of the lockdowns and restrictions we've taken so far this year haven't just been in vain. For every person who will have managed to avoid it until they're vaccinated, that's potentially one less death from it that this country will have to suffer. I guess my naive hope right now is that eventually they'll try to immunise everyone just to try and get things back to normal again. I don't think anybody's fully optimistic about a vaccine ending all of this, but that doesn't stop a lot of people in the comments section from taking the opposite stance, which is to outrightly dismiss them as useless. I prefer to be cautiously optimistic, seeing even temporary defence against the virus as being a powerful tool that we can use to get numbers down and under control, while allowing the world to carry on a little bit more normally than it otherwise would, at least for a while. I think 10 years ago I'd have felt smart and knowledgeable by taking the most negative stance I could towards this sort of stuff, but these days I prefer to be a bit more positive, even if it does risk criticism from those of a cynical disposition. Having a laugh at a bad situation is my preferred way of coping with things. If I was in a country that wasn't suffering from coronavirus, it could come across as mean or cruel. But since England is Europe's America, first in this continent to reach 50,000 deaths and sporting battle plans that even I can see gaping flaws in, I feel entitled to a bit of a laugh at this whole mess.
Work from home if you can, but you should go to work if you can't work from home.
Stay indoors. If you can work from home, go to work. Don't go to work.
I can appreciate Matt Lucas's excellent impression of, not just Boris Johnson, but also the UK's guidelines on this pandemic. Yes, it's rather old now, but I still find it amusing how much Corona beer I find sitting about in shops. Herman Cain, an American politician, tweeted that coronavirus is not as deadly as mainstream media has made it out to be, weeks after he died from it. I laughed at this outfit at first, but I'm now beginning to think it might really be a clever idea. I'd feel amazing going out in an outfit like this. And just the fact that news stories like this exist make me laugh and despair at what mankind's become. But even for me, there is currently a morbid, depressing note about this with no upside that I can see. A mutation of the virus has occurred on Mink farms, leading to mass culls of these lovely fluffy creatures, and creating a new strain of the virus that's apparently harder for our antibodies to beat. And if this strain spreads, then it could throw a spanner in the works at any current attempt at a vaccine. Oh, and I've just remembered about Brexit. That'll be fun too. 2020 is not a happy year, but I think you'll agree, it's certainly an interesting one.